This episode is brought to you by our patrons over at patreon.com/journeytomicro. If you'd like to join our community of Patreon supporters, you can sign up for just $2 a month. With that, you'll not only be supporting these videos, but you'll also get access to our patron-only Discord, and you'll get a monthly hour-long video of some of our uncut footage. If you join our $8 tier, you will still get access to the Discord and monthly uncut videos, but you'll also get weekly high-res wallpapers and your name in the list of supporters that we show at the end of every episode. Also, you'll get our Microcosmos field guide and our coloring book absolutely free. So check out our Patreon today over at patreon.com/journeytomicro. I don't know if you can tell this yet, but you are looking at a killer. Its body is long with many threads, and it seems more like a crack on the screen than a living organism. Things may seem quiet and calm, but along its body, the killer wears its victims. It would be understandable, though, if you missed that part. Those victims have been so engulfed from within by their enemy that they look more like unusual leaves or bits of debris, not an animal swimming around the microcosmos, and certainly not a rotifer caught in the strands of a predaceous fungus. If you've been following Journey to the Microcosmos for some time, this might sound like a familiar story. A few years ago, we featured a horror story of sorts, starring a fungus that spins a web to trap worms. So consider this a proper slasher movie sequel. You don't need to have seen the original to understand what's happening, but we do hope that when you're done watching rotifers suffer their ultimate ends under strange circumstances, you might want to go back and watch some nematodes suffer a similar fate. Sequels are, of course, tricky things, and you run the challenge of treading a lot of the same ground. Of course, we will have plenty of violence and death, but fortunately, this rotifer-packed sequel brings something else to the table that nematodes didn't have. Sex. But first to the violence and death. There are at least 60 species of fungi that we know of that attack rotifers. Much of what we know about these species comes from scientists using rotifers as bait. They take a sample of rotifers and then they add a bit of soil to see if the fungus is in there, and then they watch. Sounds a little dark when we phrase it that way, but of course, here we are, watching this zoophagous fungus that was growing inside of a humidity chamber as it eats away at a rotifer. From a distance, the fungus seems so dull and uninteresting. It's not even moving. Except, of course, that it is. Inside the fungus, there's a flurry of activity as nutrients and molecules stream through the cytoplasm and across the vast expanses of this predator's body. This rotifer has been caught by a fungus, flopping from side to side while the fungus seems to do nothing. An animal that can swim up against an organism that can't move. That shouldn't be a fight, but the rotifer is stuck. It is caught on adhesive pegs that line the fungus, making it impossible for the rotifer to escape. And then there are the hyphae, the threads of the fungus that grow and lie in wait. Soon, the rotifer will be more like this, immobilized and ensnared in a cyst. The fungus's digestive hyphae are embedded within the rotifer's body now and eating it from within. It takes only about a day for a fungus to trap and consume its prey like this, but it is still not done. Within another day, the rotifer will essentially be filled with hyphae, some even beginning to poke back through the body of its prey. The fungus has been feeding and feeding, but still it is not done. Within another day, the hyphae will produce spores, planting the seed for the fungi's future, all at the expense of that rotifer. In 1954, one scientist documenting the various fungal attacks on rotifers within his lab noticed that they seemed to have an unusual preference. They seemed to only target rotifers that have a lorica, which is like a shell. The soft-bodied rotifers within their samples seemed to be able to wander all around the fungi with no problem. And that sounds, like, wrong, right? Shells are protective. They keep you safe from things that are trying to eat you. But the shells are not a deterrent to the fungi, quite the opposite. In fact, the fungi seem to use the shell as a place to hook their hyphae into, using the rotifer's shield instead as a tool for invasion. These fungi also go after another type of rotifer, the deloid rotifers, a class of rotifers that is fairly large, encompassing hundreds of species. These rotifers are known for one very specific thing. No one has ever observed them having sex. It's not like they're shy or anything. They don't know we're watching. They just don't seem to do it. Maybe there's been some very recent work sifting through their genomes that suggests that maybe sexual reproduction has showed up in their past, but that's a discussion for another day. For now, the fact remains that no one has seen deloid rotifers actually engaging in sexual reproduction, and not for a lack of looking. Even more curiously, no one has ever seen what is confirmed to be a male deloid rotifer. There are, as far as we know, only female deloid rotifers. They reproduce through parthenogenesis, able to make their own egg that will hatch into a daughter that only has her mother's genes. Scientists have wondered about this process for some time, and how deloid rotifers have been able to survive for millions and millions of years without the advantages that sexual reproduction confers on a species, like the ability to introduce variation that could help them adapt to the world around them, a world that includes predatory fungi. But that's also led scientists to wonder if perhaps these fungi are the reason why deloid rotifers are so singularly reliant on asexual reproduction. Because asexual reproduction has at least one clear advantage on sexual reproduction. It is faster. You don't have to spend time finding a mate or expend energy with all of the various processes involved with courting and copulating that nature has engineered. That's potentially useful to an animal that finds itself on the run from a fungus. And deloid rotifers have another secret weapon. They are extremely hardy, able to turn into a dormant ton that can survive extreme conditions. And that means they could survive something like a strong wind, which could blow them away from their predators and drop them off in a new home that is hopefully a little less fungal. So this ability to outrun their predators and to quickly reproduce when they reach a new, less threatening environment, that's a potentially powerful combination. One that could serve to explain why deloid rotifers focus on asexual reproduction at the expense of everything else. But it is, for now, still just one idea for why deloid rotifers live the way they do. The reality is probably even more complex than what we know now, filled with even more twists than the fungus that hunts this rotifer, and more sequels than we will probably ever know. Thank you for coming on this journey with us as we explore the unseen world that surrounds us. The people on the screen right now, that's right, they are our $8 Patreon patrons. So thank you so much to everybody who's ever signed up to be a patron of Journey to the Microcosmos, especially the people who are currently signed up right now. You can check it out at patreon.com/journeytomicro, and you can be one of the people who are the reason why this thing can exist. If you want to see more from our master of microscopes, James Weiss, check out Jam and Germs on Instagram. And if you want to see more from us, there's probably a subscribe button somewhere nearby. And if you want to hit the little notification bell, you can, but please do it softly. We're trying to stay chill around here.